God, I don't know if I can even answer it anymore. What is outsider art? Basically, outsider art is... No, I can't remember. I'll start again.
What is outsider art? I don't know, you got me. I've been trying to figure that out. I've certainly been called worse things in my life than an outsider artist.
Is that somebody that's working outside, you know, that doesn't mind if it rains or something and they'll draw outside? That's what I would have said, you know. in fact, I was a bit of an outsider artist. I was over on a bench over in Hyde Park, laying low from the cops at night, doing drawings and such.
Well, what do you mean?
Well, I mean, do you feel like an outsider?
Well, I suppose so, but I mean, but what does an outsider, what does an insider feel like?
How do you say the name?
Outsider art.
Outsider? I don't know. Maybe it's for a different planet, represent for me. Outsider.
But whatever you call it, when you see it, you know it. You know, you're looking for things that make you go, oh my God. And that's outsider art.
Once upon a time, in the Italian countryside, not far from Venice, there lived a young boy named Carlo Zinelli. Carlo's mother died when he was very young, and he was taken out of school to go and work in the fields, tending to his father's cattle. When he grew into a young man, he joined the army and was sent off to fight in a terrible war. But he returned after just 2 months, and anyone who knew Carlo could tell that something was very wrong with him. He behaved strangely and refused to utter a single word. They tried to cure him with electricity, but that didn't work. And so he was sent away to an asylum with high walls and locks on the doors. And there he would stay, hidden from the world. One day, Carlo picked up a stone from the ground and began to draw on the walls. The nurses stopped him immediately, but Carlo couldn't stop. He wanted to draw everywhere, on anything. After a while, the doctors realized it kept him quiet, and so they gave him some broken old pencils and left him to it. Then one day, a Scottish artist called Michael Noble arrived. He was married to a rich Italian contessa and had come to the hospital to cure his fondness for whiskey. He saw what Carlo was doing with primitive equipment and was outraged. This man is an artist. You must let him create. And so, with the Contessa's money, Michael Noble created a studio inside the asylum with good brushes and plenty of paint. Carlo Zinelli may have been unable to talk, but something else poured out of him. The floodgates opened. Carlo spent 8 hours painting every day, completely engrossed in his work. By the time he died, he had made nearly 2,000 paintings. These works were once dismissed as the scrawlings of a lunatic. Now, Carlo Zinelli's work is on show 70 miles from the asylum, at the biggest and most prestigious event in the art calendar.
Thank you.
It's early summer, and the Venice Biennale is just beginning. This festival is a barometer for the contemporary art world. It reflects current trends. And this year, so-called outsider artists like Carlo Zanelli are the hot topic.
And Carlo became very prolific, and he started doing more and more work. His psychiatrist then took his art to see Jean de Buffet and André Breton.
Carlo's work is here in Venice thanks to this man, the director of the Museum of Everything.
The crosses there upside down must be the graves of the soldiers, and that star is the star of the Alpini soldiers, which he was conscripted into.
And you see that star everywhere, don't you?
Everywhere. I think there are all kinds of riddles hidden in there, but I think they're just for him. From what I know, he didn't care. The minute he finished one, he sort of threw it away. And the nurses and doctors would grab them up, and quite a lot of them would make their way into their homes.
But what happened to this work in the interim?
Generally speaking, Carlo's been curated by and for, let's say, the outsider Art Brut audience. And that's why it stayed this sort of secret, I guess.
Well, that secret is now well and truly out. The keynote exhibition here is the Encyclopedic Palace, where self-taught artists rub shoulders with big names from the contemporary art world. Have a look at these. They were made by a 38-year-old man with absolutely no artistic training. This man saw visions and heard voices. In private, he induced hallucinations and then recorded everything in small journals, a process he kept up for 16 years. That man was Carl Jung, one of the founding fathers of modern psychology. Is he an outsider artist?
I don't like to distinguish between insiders and outsiders, and that's what this exhibition is about. I've learned, particularly from artists, that artists are curious about any visual manifestations, and so I wanted to make a show for artists and for the public in which the distinctions between the professional and the self-taught are blurred.
What this Biennale does is disrupt the story of art as most of us know it. It brings us back to the most basic questions about the power and the purpose of art.
Well, what if there's this inborn urge to be an artist? Inborn in these guys who have no chance. The thing that I think we look for in art is a kind of urgency, like the artist could not help but do it. And what we have in contemporary art right now is a lot of calculation.
Where the artist
could... There's no sense of that urgency or necessity.
It's fantastic to see here all these artists who were always marginalized until now.
And they're together with artists, and this is where they belong, obviously.
And by the way, excuse me, Caravaggio was homeless, incarcerated, and insane. And 90% of the artists I've ever met are kind of a little insane, so boom.
I just have to say, I've never seen a Venice Biennale as strong as this one. And for me, it's really, I think this is a turn in history. I mean, it's a rupture. It's very, very important.
Some of the best work in Venice is by an outsider artist called Shinichi Sawada. The young man who made these strange and wonderful creatures works in almost total isolation at the top of a mountain in the backwoods of Japan.
ほとんど本人はですね、言葉がありませんのでね、こちらもその言葉で相手を知ろうとしてもこれはとても無理だということで、お互いのその意欲ですか、表情ですね、表情でお互いに感じ取ると、それしかないですね、今は。だから毎日ですね、一緒にこうしてですね、付き合い、お互いに付き合いしていませんとね、 ということなんですね。あの、術のところ、それが分かればですね、いいんですけど、私自身も一緒にいてて、まだまだ分かりませんですね。ただ、あれが出てきたというのは、こちらが教えたわけでも何でもないんですけれども。Sawada's
magical and monstrous creatures seem to be the fruits of a personal mythology.
Kaiju.
His work has been shown in Venice, London, Paris, Amsterdam, an exhibition record that would be the envy of any goldsmith's graduate his age. But unlike those graduates, Sawada isn't engaged with the art world, the merry-go-round of dealers, openings, and endless networking. His autism means he is unable to engage with it. Why does he make these things? It's not for profit, certainly not for fame. Where does this urge to create come from? Japanese society expects everyone to play a productive role, whatever condition they may have. Akane Kimura makes 0.8 of a yen, that's half a pence, for every sponge she puts in a plastic envelope. In the afternoon, she draws. And those pictures have been exhibited in museums across the world.
その絵を描いた後に興味がなくなっているということは、描いている瞬間をすごく楽しんでいるということだと思うんですよ。でも描き上がった後、それがこう人に認められているとか、それに価値がついたとか、そういうこと自体には多分ご本人さんは興味がないんじゃないかなと思います。
This is Nobuji Higa. One day, he was given a book of coffee table erotica. But he transforms those photographs into something altogether different.
Thank you.
ちょっとあったけどなんか評価もちょっとありましたけど評価もなんか良かった良い評価もあった。なんか女性のあれちょっと結構不なんでなんか女性なんか結構なんか言われるかなと思ったのだからいやこういうことも批判があるかなと思ってどうもなんか良かった。
It was in the 1940s that a French artist called Jean de Buffet first brought self-taught art out of the asylums and into the galleries. De Buffet christened it Art Brut, a legacy of his days in the wine trade, where brut means raw or unsugared. He was interested in the lack of sophistication of the work, which he saw as its purity. For him, a spontaneous outpouring from the wellspring of creativity was the mark of true art.
Cet art-là me paraît à moi le grand art et le seul art véritablement authentique, véritablement créatif. Ce que j'ai recherché moi, ce sont des formes d'art étrangères à la culture et délibérément étrangères à la culture.
De Buffet toured asylums in Central Europe, hoovering up work and creating an alternative canon of art brut. He discovered people like Aloise Corbaz, a Swiss governess whose imagined affair with Kaiser Wilhelm II led to an erotic outpouring of drawings, collage and murals. Or Adolf Wölfli, a schizophrenic goatherd and labourer who produced over 25,000 pages of drawings, literature, and music in his own invented notation, all of which he signed St. Adolf II. De Buffet often had problems finding art because the hospitals rarely archived it. The psychiatric world didn't fully appreciate the value of what their patients were making. But times have changed. Here in the forest north of Vienna lies the Art Brut Center, Gugging. Gugging is famous for its house of artists, home to 14 psychiatric patients who've been plucked from the Austrian system, thanks to their artistic talent. Unlike the day centers of Japan, these artists live here full time. There is no obligation for them to make art, but still, it pours out of them. So you brought the outsiders inside, and how has the art world responded then to that?
In the 80s, it was very difficult, because on one hand, the world of psychiatry didn't understand it. And on the other hand, the art world saw this experiment. It was not really presented as art, you know? So what I wanted to show is that also single pieces of art of every good apparent artist has the same worth as any other piece, single piece of any other kind of art. If you buy a Van Gogh, you have to pay $200 million. And then the illness doesn't play any role.
So it's the art that's important, is what you're saying. And let's not focus on the case studies, but how do you look after the artist then?
One thing is the private life of an artist, and the other thing is his professional life as an artist. So, on the one hand, we supported the artist in their private needs, you know, with illness or whatever, you know. And on the other side, we managed more or less their art. We organized exhibitions, we made publications, and we selected their works because they themselves couldn't select so much. It's the same work as any gallerist works with his artist, wherever.
Perhaps the best known Gugging artist is the now deceased August Waller. It was almost as though his creative urges could not be contained within his room and exploded into the surrounding countryside, which he peppered with his work on any available surface. The Vatican has the Sistine Chapel, and Gugging has August Waller's old room.
Think I came off Klosterneuburg in the village Weidling. Ich mal schon seit 10 Jahren hier und es und meine Bilder sind schon, waren schon zweimal in Tokio in Japan, zweimal in New York, einmal dreimal in Paris. Come on, I'll show you a picture. Look it, das ist die Karte auf der Danube, die Donaukarte. Das ist vom Anfang von Donauquelle bis zur Donaumündung. Der hohe Berg, der höchste Berg von Deutschland ist die Zugspitze, ist 3000 Meter hoch fast. Dann ist da die Donau, fließt da runter so entlang. Da will ich noch die Holung der Inn ist. 517 Kilometer. Das habe ich aus dem Gedächtnis, aus den, alles aus meinen Gedanken habe ich das als Gedächtnis. Ich bin ein Supergenie. Ich bekomme für so ein Bild 6.600 Euro. It's a lot of money.
I see we have these images of the artists on the walls here. The fact that you're selling and exhibiting this work pretty successfully, what impact does that have on the artists?
It depends on the artist. Johann Gaber is very aware of who he is. I know we went to Basel to an exhibition in a gallery there, and we have to fly with the airplane, and then he asked me, Nina, could you please carry my luggage? And I say, how comes? And he said, yeah, I'm the artist.
So in a way, they're just like all these other famous artists. They're all divas, isn't it?
Yes, yes, on one side, of course, yeah. And why not?
Mhm. Sieh, das ist mein
Picture. Mein
Picture. Mein Picture. Das auch. Das auch. Das auch.
Ich schau.
Nein, das ist nicht. Das draußen. Das ist draußen. Ich bin großer Künstler.
Ja, nehmen wir den Pinsel.
Gut.
Ja, da haben wir noch zwei.
Ja,
da legst du ihn her. Dann hole ich das Ding.
Ja. Die Schiege. Die Schiege. Muss der Kopf raus. Gute Hirn, gute Hirn. Die Zitrinen. Noch so schöne Sachen.
We have place for 14 people, nothing more. That means I invite somebody if I see that he has a talent, but if he will become an artist is a question. You never know, you know? It needs time. Sometimes it's very easy, sometimes it needs 10 years, sometimes it never will be.
You're a very patient man, Johan.
It's life goes over 80 years. And not just for 3 months, you know?
This is Gunther Schutzenhofer. He currently has a solo show at a gallery in New York.
I love his work because it doesn't look like anything that I know after doing this for 35 years.
Was ist das, Gunther?
Es ist ein Radio. Radio.
Schutzenhofer's work seems to have that ability to transport diverse people in the same way that an inkblot test does. I've seen it over and over again. You look at something and say, well, what is this image? And one person will say, oh, it's a radio, oh, it's a car, oh, it's an airplane, it's a comb, it's a... And everyone is bringing their own brain to the work. And that's a wonderful thing. Everyone is desperately trying to put outsider art into a nice, neat little box. And it doesn't really fit in because it's something that happened independently. It's something that owes nothing to art history. And when you have some, when you owe nothing to art history, you really have a problem.
This work that was not made with that trapping of, you know, will I get into one of the good galleries? Will I be in the Biennale? I mean, it's very nice that it's there. It deserves a place in the Venice Biennale. But at the same time, I don't want to be so much part of that whole, oh, what's the market doing? Because then you're like financial stocks. You should love it because it inspires you to love, not because people say, oh, this is safe now to love because it's selling big. We can all get in on it, you know? Like, what is that? I don't want that.
Well, you know, we had grand ambitions about 10 years ago that we were going to try to create a whole category at Christie's of outsider art. Unfortunately, there weren't enough investor, speculator types who would be willing to fuel the market by reselling. That is, I think, one of the problems we had with creating an auction category. Many of the passionate outsider art collectors are in some ways as obsessive as the artists they collect, and they love the works they have and they keep them.
Aren't they beautiful?
Yes, they are very beautiful.
I've been collecting this group of cars probably for about 30 years whenever I could, either if they came up in auction or from private collections or wherever. Madge Girl was controlled by a spirit guide who she named as Minor Rest.
Minor Rest, she called it.
But in my inner rest. I would think that these are a repeated self-portrait over and over and over again.
There's an obsessive quality to many of these artists. And often, like the British outsider Madge Gill, they work in isolation. Where professional artists forge their creations in a dialogue with art history, the outsider is engaged in a monologue.
One of the exciting things about seeing an outsider artist you've never seen before is that you've never seen anything like it before either. Because each outsider artist is like an art movement of one. And they invent their own techniques, their own disciplines, their own ways of working, and their own visions. And that's why they come up with something completely individual each time. Now, this is a little picture by Joe Coleman. It's a self-portrait of Joe just after he'd carried out his autopsy on a dead body in a Hungarian hospital. And that's him there. It's called The Pathologist. I couldn't afford his paintings. They're so expensive. There's big paintings about this big. So I said, oh, Joe, can you just do me a little tiny painting that I could just about afford? And so that's done. But our little grandson is really frightened of it.
Welcome to the auditorium. I got kicked out of art school, and then they asked me to be an advisor many years later after I had a certain following at that point. And so I said, okay, I'll be an advisor. So immediately I told the kid, get the fuck out of school, because you're not going to learn a goddamn thing in that school. You have to go out there and live, you know, and that's where you're going to find your art, not in art school. At home, it was really pretty fucked up because, you know, my father was a pretty violent alcoholic and he tormented my mother and the rest of the family. And I found release and relief in drawing. When I started painting, my brush strokes were bigger. And now I barely even move my brush. And it's a one-hair brush and I use jeweler's lenses. I'm looking for more and more information on the surface of the painting. Even though it's coming out of somewhere, I mean, out there or in here, but it's appearing here and that's where I'm finding it. And the more minute that I look, the more that I find. I try to take care of the misfits, you know, and the losers. The losers never get to write their side of history, except in my work.
Joe Coleman's customers include Johnny Depp and Leonardo DiCaprio. Prices for his paintings have risen steadily, and there's now a waiting list. People want the work quicker than his one-hair brush can paint it. In fact, such is his popularity that, in a peculiar twist, he's now banned from showing at the Outsider Art Fair on account of being too successful. What does this tell us? Perhaps it suggests we fetishize these artists. We prefer them to be poor and struggling. Across town lives one such artist who fits that bill.
Hi, welcome to New York. Come in. Come in here.
Yeah, now you can do. It's okay?
When Ionel Talpazan was still a boy in Romania, he had an encounter with what he believes was a UFO, which bathed him in a strange blue light. His life's work is an attempt to make sense of this.
This is my spaceship's UFOs. I work many sizes. I make this soy because the color, because this blue, color blue, for me represent double energy, the inspiration me to create this drawing, art and everything. Second spaceship's UFO launch. But it's still not finished in process. Because I'm a problem, financial problem, I can finish. Go ahead. Maybe you like it. All my art, I do experiment. Look at the lot of material. I broke a lot of things, a lot of canvas. The artist is like an astronaut. With the mind, you can travel the entire universe.
Ionel's parents sold him for just under £100 when he was a baby. As a young man, he took drastic measures to escape the Ceausescu regime and swam the Danube from Romania to Yugoslavia, eventually finding refuge in the United States. He's lived in this one-room apartment in Harlem for 18 years.
It was at the Outsider Art Fair. I had a booth there. I used to show the outsiders' work there. But Ionel used to be outside in the snow every day selling his artwork on the street. So in a way, Ionel shot himself in the foot because he was always outside selling his work for a fraction of the cost that I would like to have sold it for on my booth at the fair.
I sell painting for me sometimes. I'm starting actually for $10 the size. Sometimes a couple hundred dollars, but a couple hundred dollars sometimes. But it's not happening every day. I like to sell direct. No consignments, no contract. Low. I need money. I need survive. This is the original in colors, the way I look at my spaceship's UFO. Actually, this position. I have some idea about vacuum. Somewhere like, take the vacuum transformation in energy and field system, field magnetic, anti-magnetic dimension. I know I have only one idea. I have six. You don't need to make bomb atomic to destroy this planet. You need to use this source of energy to travel the universe forever. But it's different time, different spaceships, UFO, different work. See? I do different. My art is unique art. Unique mind, unique art on planet Earth.
Ionel may be ploughing a lonely furrow, but then again, they all laughed at Christopher Columbus when he said the world was round. They all laughed when Edison recorded sound. The alternative guide to the universe is brimming with mavericks. Self-taught artists, unlicensed architects, fringe physicists, and visionary inventors. Hayward Gallery director Ralph Rugoff treated me to a private tour as it was hung.
Something about his movement. It's quite scary, isn't it?
Wu Yulu is a farmer in China who's taught himself how to make robots using, again, whatever materials at hand. And he's made robots who commit suicide, robots who smoke cigarettes, robots who do the dishes for him. And this is a child robot. When you think about the idea of a child robot in China, given China's policy of only one child per family, who's going to be a sibling for all those single children? This is a remarkable French artist named Marcel Storr. These are all made in the 1970s. He was an orphan, he was deaf. He worked as a street sweeper in the Bois de Boulogne, and he would go home at night and make these incredibly intricate drawings. And these were cityscapes he called megalopolises, and this was his blueprint for the rebuilding of Paris, which he was convinced was going to be destroyed in a nuclear attack. This was one of his last unfinished works. Wow. And I mean, it gives you a sense of how he worked, which is great. Incredibly detailed, the painstaking, elaborate lines that he's drawing, where they're so small, I can't even see them with my eye anymore, you know?
Yeah. It's this idea also in this art, if you can't live in the real world, you know, or you're not happy there, then create an alternative reality for yourself, and that's what he seems to have done.
Paul Laffoley is an inventor of all kinds of devices. He was one of the assistant architects helping on the original World Trade Center in New York, and at a certain point, he went off in a different direction.
It's good to be unknown for a long time, because then you can actually, you know, pump up what you're doing and make it into a format where they can't destroy it. Because if you're in an art school, that's the worst place to go. And that's the one thing I said to myself, never enter an art school. But I did go to an architectural school, but got kicked out after 1 year for conceptual deviance.
Paul came up with plans for a time machine where your body doesn't travel through time. You're just able to see what different times look like. Mentally, you can project yourself. Yeah, I mean, but Stephen Hawking said we'll see a time machine in the next 50 years. Laffoley says he had an encounter with an alien intelligence that changed his life, and that directed him to make this painting, and that if you put your hands, this is the left hand of the past, the right hand of the future, if you put your hands, Alan, on those two things, and put your head forward, you're supposed to be able to download intelligence from another dimension. You look different.
I'll let you know. So this is a sort of injection of something, also you could see it in Venice as well. A different way of looking at the world, a sort of mutation of art and science and mathematics and mysticism.
I think a lot of this work in this show harkens back to a kind of Renaissance moment when science and art weren't so different.
If you think about Leonardo and Michelangelo, and they were making weaponry, they were thinking about flight, they were thinking, you know, about science as well as thinking about art.
They were all engaged in the pursuit of knowledge and in understanding what it meant to be human, which is something contemporary art has lost sight of, because supposedly now we have experts who look after that for all of us. All these people on this show are people who've decided they don't want the experts to look after it. They've got their own ideas about how this works. George Widener is the kind of person who will see a license plate, it'll make him think of a date. It'll be Thursday. He'll then think of every event he's ever read or heard of that happened on a Thursday with that number date. And he's made landscapes, whole cities, based on these ideas of time. George believes in this idea called the singularity, which is that in the near future, machines will become intelligent. We'll have artificial intelligence. And a lot of people put this date at 2045, which now is starting to seem not that far away.
I started to listen to this voice inside of me and stuff that was interested in these patterns, and it started to become very strong. You know, I was institutionalized at one point, you know, because going over these things in my head over and over and over and over and over again. There's a thing called a magic square. These numbers, if you add them up this way, they add up to 34. If you add them up this way, they add up to 34, right? In all directions, they add up to an identical sum of 34. And in the case of this sculpture, all these, this 2, 17, 29, 11, 10, 5, and 13 add up to 70. And I create symmetrical patterns using the days of the week. And there's this linkage between the present, the past, and the future. What happened in the past was I was, you know, trying to do too much in my life. And I kind of got overwhelmed and went from being an engineering scholar to being on the streets and stuff. Now I'm in galleries. I associate with dealers, art dealers. I show at art fairs. I sell my work. You know, so what to make of it? I don't know, you know. I don't think about it too much, you know. If you were to look at the Fridays of 1912, it's January 5, 12, 19, 26, February 2, 9, 16, 23, March 1, 8, 15, 22, 29, April 5, 12, 19, 26, May 3, 10, 17, 24, 31, so on, you know. So I see them in my head. They line up and stuff, and I feel that there will be huge technological changes in the future. Machines will be able to scan these very rapidly and see these interconnections and find this sort of interesting. They're going to need artwork too, the robots and machines of the future. So I'm simply making some work for them and stuff to relax with and stuff. I'm just being useful, I think. That's what I'm doing, you know.
The Museum of Everything started life in a former dairy in 2009. It has an exceptional collection of outsider art, and just as revolutionary as the work is the way it's presented. With no fixed abode, it takes over spaces for a limited time only. The ramshackle, hand-knitted aesthetic is the work of Yves Stewart, the award-winning production designer of Les Mis and The King's Speech. It's playful and unpretentious, a million miles from the intimidating white space of most contemporary galleries. Here it is again, popping up in London, in Selfridges. Who else would think to stage an art exhibition slap bang in the middle of Oxford Street? This man pops up everywhere too. The museum's freewheeling director, James Brett. Now he is the ringmaster of a traveling circus as it hurtles across Russia, sniffing out secret works by unknown artists. This convoy has collected new work in four different Russian cities. And now it has come to a stop in Moscow for a huge show of that work at Dasha Zukova's garage.
this very graphic work is by Oleg Gordev, who's a street cleaner and a handyman, and he's a self-taught historian. And when you talk to him, actually, he was a really troublesome kid and I think narrowly escaped being in prison. And he's a sweet character. But obviously, as you can see in this wall, there's a lot of Nazis. It's one thing to have one Hitler in your show. We've got two Hitlers. But that Hitler is what sort of sold me on him, because it's Hitler, and he's just realized he's lost the war. And if you look at his features, you can see the pain. This one, which is again, you know, same period, it's a Russian soldier seductively licking the cheek of a female Nazi officer. And there's something about the humor of the whole thing, but actually he's thrilled by these episodes of war. And I somehow nobody else was doing it like that. I certainly hope he's not a fascist. I can't really tell. I have a really complicated relationship with this artist. The first time I saw her work, I was very confident, not for us, thanks very much, because it's too simple in its depiction of the world. But this woman is far from simple, and once I started looking at what she does, you happen to be pointing the camera at the ones that changed my mind. The artist, Pejova, she's about 80 years old, she's not skinny, and she lives in this apartment block and is very proud of what I think is 150 or so lovers that she's had during her lifetime. She's a very erotic woman. You know, you haven't just got animals doing it with their own species, you've got animals doing it with other species, and then things get worse. This is not a one-off or a two-off. There are hundreds of these pictures. It's not that these are masterpieces, but still, I'm in love with this picture. I mean, the two brontosauruses making out by the river, it's just phenomenal. And it probably happened. This artist you've got to look at. I mean, you need to take a big look. This is a 15-year project of one man who goes every day to the park in Nizhny Novgorod and paints the same or virtually the same landscape. And what he's documenting from the top of this to the bottom is the weather. My only sadness is we were only able to get a year off Victor. I was hoping for 5 years. The whole of this museum in Moscow couldn't contain all 15 years. It took us 6 months to persuade him to allow us to show it here, partially because he said, well, look, someone's going to call up and they're going to need to know what was the weather March 2010. I said, no one's going to call you up. This is a great opportunity to communicate your life's work. There are very few contemporary artists who would spend 15 years on one project. He didn't even make it to the opening of the exhibition because he was afraid that he would miss a day of doing this.
It's здорово, потому что статус самодеятельного художника повышается, что это не двоюродные братья.
Я не вписана в, как бы, ну, в contemporary процесс. С другой стороны, что значит outside? Может быть, все мы, кого называют аутсайдерами, на самом деле не в самом конце, а в самом начале.
I love the word outsider at the beginning because, of course, I felt it associated with me, and I can be weird. And I like that weirdness, I like my differences. But the more I looked into it, the more I thought this just can't be correct. I realized that the mainstream museums were using it to segregate. The other big thing for me is not to present it as the work of a bunch of crazy people. I mean, if I'm really frank, that's often the assumption. And so the other key issue is to say, look, who's crazy? Who's disabled? Who's able? Why do we think that if someone has a mental health issue, it's just a cut and dry thing? Everybody has a mental health issue, it's a question of degree. And once you start to understand that, I think you take a step back into creativity and our reasons for making.
why do we create? Picasso said that every child is an artist. The problem is how to remain one once we grow up.
Welcome to Critical Thought Center. Critical Thought Center is a good place. Yeah, let's go do it.
San Francisco has always been a crucible for radical ideas. So it's no surprise that it's home to creative growth. Every day, more than 100 people that society calls disabled come here to make art.
The notion was by the founders originally, Elias Katz and his wife Florence, that there's an innate creative impulse in all humans. And given encouragement and materials, that will come out.
Dan Miller was the first creative growth artist to have his work bought by New York's Museum of Modern Art.
For me, when I watch Dan work, you see a kind of anxiety and frustration, almost as if everything he needs to say is in his head and he's just really struggling with getting it out. For most of us who are speech enabled, we were talking it out, and Dan doesn't seem to be able to, so he needs to draw it out and really hope that someone will understand, will get the translation, that will get the urgency of his message.
Don't pick up the ball cap. Right?
Right, Danny?
I love the atmosphere of this place. You can walk in off the street and just talk to the artist, buy a piece of work, or a limited edition comic book, or even a T-shirt.
Now, brown is the color of chocolate, which we all know and love. Taste that chocolate and you cannot tell if it's made from Hershey, Ghirardelli, or Dove. For in that tasty chocolate delight, there is no black, there is no white.
Oh, DJ Disco Duck, that's me.
The All-Star Chocolate Heroes. You've created a whole new universe here.
Oh, yes.
Where did the All-Star Chocolate Heroes come from?
Well, it all just came from my head when I decided to have some superheroes of my own. And the comic book right here is gonna help me start my own business in entertainment. And a lot of people, whether they're my family or friends, are really proud of me of working real hard on this one.
Time you get busy up in here. This is their crib. Their crib is where they live, I take it.
Yeah, yeah. Green Nose, he's the type of arch enemy who hates He hates everything to do with chocolate. He doesn't even like to drink hot chocolate because he thinks that chocolate is no fun, but that's not really true. Chocolate can be fun.
Now that you've captured Green Nose, let's head down to Mel's for a chocolate shake.
Yes.
So
So it all ends.
That was their reward for capturing.
Oh, here they are having their chocolate shake.
I dedicate this one to all the ladies who have pretty feet and for men and guys who appreciate women's pretty feet. They can express how they feel like I have. They can say nice things about a woman's pretty feet in a sweet, positive, symbolized manner like I have.
Beth Emily, you can't quite see their feet though.
Well, I can, because I have good vision. And here's where their feet are at. Right now I'm dealing with hair loss, but I'll have a plan to get my hair back.
You've got a plan, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Let me know about it.
Oh, yes.
Once upon a time, in a rough part of San Francisco, there lived a boy called William. He was different to the other kids. And they would tease him at school. He would walk home and try to ignore the drunk men shouting in his street. Sometimes he heard gunshots outside his window. He wished they would go away. Then one day, he came here and began to draw. He drew the people who had been shot back to life. He drew his city, but the way he wanted it to be. And he drew beautiful and strong women he'd never met.
Yeah, look what I drew right here. So I drew right here, like long language. It's a Queen Sheba. See, she's a peacemaker, low language, the peacemaker, and she has beautiful eyes.
Hey, I just got back from another world. It was way, way past another side. It was across the mountain and through the seas, past the moon, beyond all things that we've dreamed about. You never in your life seen such color. That glows like a twinkle in an eye.
The Museum of Modern Art in New York now has four of William Scott's paintings. He's also fond of making Halloween masks. And yes, that was him in Selfridge's window.
William's been doing a series of paintings very recently about reinventing his life in the 70s. So William paints himself as either a successful basketball player or popular with the prom or with a happy, healthy family. And what he's doing is he's going back to those transformative years to make them better, to make his life today better, to make the disability go away, to make an injury to his body that he had then disappear.
This is a me right here, that's me. It was on the beach at San Cruz Beach Boardwalk in another life of 1974, another life. Yeah, I'm gonna be like that and wearing an afro and be like that. I'm gonna be like that wearing an afro with my new body. With my new body, a perfect body.
That's Michael Jackson. Yeah. So you're on the front cover of Modern Painters, were you?
Yeah, that's right.
That's a great picture. That's Christina.
The invention, yeah.
Dear Christina Hernandez, I have been single for a long time. I am tired being, it bothers me too much. I wanted a wife real bad. I've never had any kids. I wanted to become a father for good. Christina, I wanted you to be putting me into friendship and social skills.
Yeah.
Have you developed your friendship and social skills?
No.
You're pretty lovable, William, I think.
Yeah, uh-huh.
There's something very moving and powerful about this place. It feels like an environment where anything is possible. And there's room for wit, for charm, and for mystery and magic. Art is about looking at the world in different ways. It lets us see things through the eyes of its maker. And in doing so, it refreshes our own view of the world. It's a tonic for the imagination. Every one of these artists has created and inhabits their own world with such conviction that it becomes recognizable to us. And the best part of all is that we are invited to step inside.
Okay, that's it. That's it, Jack. It's a wrap. What are we doing here?